Welcome to Praise Chapel Fresno, where we strive to nurture an environment where all individuals are welcomed, encouraged, and connected to the Spirit of God. We are so excited you've joined us today, where you can do so in person or online every Sunday at 10 a.m. and stay connected to us through our website or any one of our social media platforms. You can continue to support this movement with your participation, your viewership, your prayers, and your giving. All financial contributions can be done digitally at our website, praisechapelfresno.com, or physically at the address of our building. Thank you, and again, welcome to Praise Chapel Fresno.
With a heart of worship, I'm bringing in a brand new song. I'm ready to see the unthinkable. I'm ready for a miracle. Hearts praying for a fresh encounter. Souls looking to the living God. I'm ready for a real revival. Oh, Holy Spirit, come like a flood, like a fire. Holy Spirit, fall in this place, fill our hearts. Holy Spirit, come like a flood, like a fire. Holy Spirit, come. Oh, Holy Spirit, come. We're on the edge of a new beginning. God, we know you have so much more. We're looking to a new horizon. We're praying for your rain to pour. An overflowing of true redemption. An overflowing of your kingdom. We're ready for a real revival. Oh, Holy Spirit, come like a flood, like a fire. Holy Spirit, fall in this place, fill our hearts. Holy Spirit, come like a flood, like a fire. Holy Spirit, come. Oh, Holy Spirit, come. Heaven is reaching. Oh, can you hear it? Our God is speaking. Oh, can you see it? He's got your healing. Oh, just receive it. Receive the freedom. Oh, can you feel it? Heaven is reaching. Oh, can you hear it? Our God is speaking. Oh, can you see it? He's got your healing. Oh, just receive it. Receive the freedom. Come
like a flood, like a fire. Holy Spirit, fall in this place. Fill our hearts.
Holy Spirit, come.
All my life you have been.
I've got nothing new. How could I express all my gratitude? I could sing these songs as I often do, but every song must end. Just one move with my arms stretched wide. Sing it, church. Yeah. to pray or sing, church, just sing, oh, say, oh, 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 oh. You can't shy on me, lift up your song, 'cause you got a lion inside of those bones. Get up and praise the Lord. So come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song, 'cause you got a lion. Jesus Christ, Lord God, to call upon, Lord, not just for redemption, not just for salvation, but Lord God, for strength, for peace in our troubled times. Father, I pray right now, Lord God, that we just begin to lift up our voices, Lord God. Let the lion of the tribe of Judah out of your lungs whenever you're facing your trials, your struggles, your tribulations. Just begin to open your mouth and speak the name of Jesus Christ. Begin to speak and worship his name, and you'll begin to see everything just begin to fall away, and all will become calm, and you'll see a way when there wasn't one before. But Father, we thank you for all that you've done. But Lord, we wait with anticipation for what you have yet to do in this place with your people. In your holy and precious name we pray, amen and amen.
Welcome. I'm Lead Pastor, and you have made the right decision to be here today, and we are so excited you joined us at Praise Chapel Fresno. Whether you're joining us in our online community or here at our facility, we have services every Sunday morning at 10 a.m. and every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. We also provide a variety of Zoom meetings throughout the week. Now, if you're looking for topics, dates, or times, please visit our website at praisechapelfresno.com. And stay connected with us as we continue to see God move through this church by following us on any one of our social media platforms like Facebook, Instagram, or YouTube. Now, as lead pastor, I am honored to be part of a church that has been servicing the city of Fresno for over 35 years. But all we've been able to accomplish has only been possible through the financial support this church receives through tithes and offerings. Now, in the book of Luke, chapter 6, the Bible tells us that what we give will be given to us, that the measure we use to give, God will be measured back to us in our own life. Now, in my life, I've witnessed the benefits of tithing and giving to my church, and God has always answered the need. We have several options available for tithing, such as Easy Tithe, an app-based program found in the Apple Store or in Google Play. You can give directly through our website, or you can mail in or drop off your support at the address of our facility. We'd like to ask you to check all your electronic devices and please place them on silent or vibrate, as we do not want to disturb what God is about to do. From all the support staff here at Praise Chapel Fresno, we invite you to sit back, open your hearts, open your minds, because I have an expectation that God is going to move through your life today.
Amen. We have a few quick updates real quick. I do apologize. Our men's bathroom is currently down right now. I mean, it's for a good reason. It's not like, you know, we're like, oh my God, someone destroyed this thing. We got to get rid of it. No, like someone literally came in and was like, y'all need to do something about your bathrooms. I'll pay for it if I have to. And we were like, no, we could just, she's like, no, I want to do this. So it's currently under work, phenomenal work being done by Michael Hogan up there. You ever need anything done, don't call Mike, call me first, because we might have him on a few things, but so just don't hop in there, and if you read our sign, no, there's not really grizzly bears in there. But also, April 20th from about 10 to about 5 or whenever. Last year for Easter, we went up to Brother Rudy Diaz's like paradise up there, his little city, and just had a barbecue, and it was such a wonderful time. A ton of people showed up, people that I was like, do you go here? Like, you don't go to Praise Chapel. Who are you? Who is you? And, you know, people just showing up, and it was such a fun time, a good time that we had up there. So we wanted to do it, but due to the way that Easter kind of fell, we kind of, Brother Rudy was like, let's push this back. So it's going to be April 20th from 10 to 5. And he, like, it's amazing out there. We're going to be doing some training up there here pretty soon. But just such an amazing place. But we would like to get a sign up, because we just want to make sure that we have enough food for everybody. We had a ton of food last time, but it was because Pastor Will went out and bought stuff. And then Brother Rudy was like, oh, no, I got this. I'll go buy some stuff. So we came with, like, double. And everyone was eating. It was great. But it's such a beautiful place up there. And I spent most of the time in his saloon. Yes, he has one. And it has been blessed by the name of Jesus Christ. The only thing that is in there to drink is the blood of Christ, all right? So, but a great time. It's a little bit of a drive, but it's always worth it. The last time I got, like, I think I gave my wife, because I'm so used to driving up there from time to time. I used to have to do that for high school. And just, I know those roads back and forth, so she's like, you're making me sick. Like, you got to stop. So we're going to be having that April 20th from 10 to 5. But again, if we can just get a quick sign up. And some other updates that everyone's just been hitting me up about. I don't know what this eclipse is going to do, okay? I'll tell you, like, there's just some crazy stuff that keeps coming up. We've been talking about this kind of consistently on our Wednesday night Bible studies, just because I get a lot of questions. So what I do is I go and I poke the hornet's nest. When someone posts something, I'll just, like, poke it and see what questions they have or see what they say to me. And then I take that, and then I use biblical scripture kind of, like, to point them in the right direction. But the eclipse is coming, and everyone's like, they're declaring states of emergency. They're only declaring states of emergencies in cities where they have total coverage, because I guess in one city they had, like, 1 million people reserve hotels in and around one site. So the governor declared a state of emergency so that the National Guard is on there. But they're like, make sure you have food, make sure you have water. Again, it's for those towns. But I will tell you, so I told Wednesday night this, and I was telling someone today, but they're like, I really don't know what's going to happen. I go, I do find it incredibly weird that the one 7 years ago that passed coming is going to cross over the only town called Rapture. It's the only city in the world named Rapture. Google it. Not now, that'd be rude. But just, like, why? And, like, I was kind of having a mental breakdown when we were with our Bible study, because I'm just like, why is there one town named Rapture, and why is that, like, why are they intersecting over it? And it just is, so I don't know. Like, am I going to say some extra prayers tonight? Absolutely. I'm going to be sitting and being like, okay, God, any unrepentant sin that I haven't voiced, Lord, cover me in the blood of Jesus Christ, just to make sure, you know, and I encourage you all to do the same, because I don't know what's going to happen, okay? It's just an eclipse at this point. But I don't want to, like, end up in heaven and see some of y'all, and you're like, Pastor, well, why didn't you tell us this was going to happen? Like, I had plans for tomorrow. I'm like, I know, I'm sorry. So just take it for what it's worth, but just that's where my mind immediately went. You have your Bibles today. I'm sorry we couldn't get our YouVersion system up, but that's because I'm just really lazy. No, I'm playing. We had a lot of work that was going on, so we don't want to stress anyone out. But I'm going to be in the book of Exodus 23. And I find this to a point that I belong to a community of pastors that all kind of like talk, and we move things back and forth. And it's like, one guy had this great revival going on in his church. He's like, I have to do multiple services out of my building. I'm just like, that's so great that God's moving. And then the next day, he's like 75% of them weren't even there. And they're like, I can't even get a hold of him. And I was like, okay. And so he was able to get some. And most of what he found out, because I'm like, no, don't be like, yo, come to church, do this. I said, just ask questions. I love doing that. Just ask questions like, hey, what happened? Like, what's going on? Or, you know, do you need any help? Do you need any assistance? You know, and most of what he found was he was like, a lot of them were just like, well, I was praying. It didn't happen. What were you praying for? Well, I was praying for deliverance from this. Okay. But I just kept doing it. Okay, step one, not God's fault. That's kind of on you. But secondly, I think we have this misconception about our prayers being answered immediately. Because, see, there are times like people will pray for something, and look, salvation is immediate. When you turn your heart to Jesus Christ and you cry for the blood of Christ to wash your sins away, that is immediate. But the rest of things that happen, God rarely moves immediately. Even, like, I know we just passed Easter, and so, you know, they always talk about, like, the crossing of the Red Sea, and you watch on the movies, and Moses gets out there, and he throws his hands apart, and it says, like, the whole thing just started splitting. That's not how it happened. Read the Bible. Read a little bit closer. It says, then the winds came and began to push the waves. So it didn't happen immediately, but they could see it happening over time, and, like, archaeologists once again have come forward and been like, all right, y'all, something's wrong. And they're like, what? They go, okay, you know how when you read in the Bible, when it says in the book of Exodus, and it says when they crossed the Red Sea that they were protecting him by a column of fire? Yeah. Okay, so I went to the exact site where it should have been, and guess what? All the sand is what? It's glass. That can't happen, because glass, for sand to turn into glass, it needs to burn at 3,000 degrees for over an hour. It is glass. There are footprints in it. That had to be hot, right? Anyway, but there are times when God is going to move immediately. God hears our prayers, and that's the problem. Like, God hears our prayers. He doesn't ignore his children, but his response is on his time, not on yours. And I'm going to show you today how God is always moving. Like, people are like, oh, no, God waits. And what we think, and I know some of y'all think this, like when you pray, you're thinking you're praying to some deity that is outside of our universe, and you have to send your prayers out. But when you look at something and like it says, oh, those that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings. Like, we have that, right? And people will pray that, and they'll be like, oh, the Lord is my strength, and I will wait on him. Well, the term wait in Hebrew means to be intertwined. It doesn't mean like, oh, I just have to wait on God. No, when you voice it, you're not voicing it to some deity that exists outside of our universe. He's right there with you. When you accept Jesus Christ and you are filled with the Holy Spirit, he is right there with you. So when you're voicing, he can hear you. He's not ignoring you. It even says in the book of Psalms, it says, he does not withhold the good from those who live with integrity. So he's not withholding anything from you, because God is very deliberate about his responses. So in turn, the waiting purifies your motive. Because see, I can get up and be like, God, that lottery done hit like over $1 billion. Lord, think of all the good things I could do with that money. And he's up there and he's like, child, if you were to take that money, the first thing you'd be doing, you'd be purchasing cars everywhere. You'd try and buy people. You'd go buy some stranded island and you would live your best life. I wouldn't even be an afterthought. And you're like, but God, I really just need like extra money. He says, you know what? I'm going to give you a little raise. I'll get the boss to chip something in. Let's see if you can manage that. But the waiting purifies your motive. Because see, some people can pray and be like, oh God, I want to get out of this situation. I wonder, and God's like, right, but sometimes the situation I have you in is exactly where I need you to be so I can work some things out. Seal that verse in your heart, though. He does not withhold the good from those who live with integrity. If God withholds something from you in your life, then this verse tells me it wasn't any good for you. Oh, but God, why'd they leave me? Why is that relationship broken? Because all I could see was the evil that was happening and what it was doing to your soul and pulling you away. It wasn't any good for you, so I took it away. If the answer is a no and it doesn't feel like God's moving on what you're praying for, then he knows it's never going to be any good for you. See, not all of God's miracles will happen immediately. Most of them are going to be progressive. They don't happen overnight. They happen over time. So someone had once reached out to me and they said, you know, I really feel like I need to get over this thing and I need some help with that. And I said, okay, like I'm gonna help you with this. And they just kept struggling until it hit a point where it was like, I'm done with this. Like, I'm just gonna do this. And I'm did I fail God because I had to include extra things to help me get over? I'm like, no, God provided a way because he knew you would need it. So it's not so much that you're sitting here and saying, well, I need to get rid of these things. God says it is a progressive movement that happens over time. Progressive means it builds. So when you pray for something and you say, God, this is what I need, he's going to move, and I'm going to show you how he's going to move in just a second. If it's not fast enough, that's according to your plan. We get impatient. We start to lose focus at where and how God is moving through our lives. See, if the enemy can't take your faith, he's going to take your focus. He's going to get you to focus off of God and on your timeline to say, see, he's not answering. I remember my darkest times, like I'm just sitting there and I'm like 3,000 miles away from my church, from my family. I'm just kind of like sitting in this room, like seriously, like what's all this even about? Like I'm dealing with these things and like I literally could feel and just like it kept running through my mind. It's because you left God. Like God didn't care enough to come back to you. God didn't care enough to stay. And like I'm sitting there and like I start hearing all my dad's sermons like going through my head that I listened to as a kid because I mean, 23, or it was at that time, I think it was like 20 years of like listening to a pastor's sermon like three times a week. Those just get imprinted in my mind. And like all those words just start coming back because the enemy's going to try to get your focus off of God and on your timeline so all you see is lack. If the enemy gets your focus off of God, it's going to come in three ways. The first thing he gets you to do is he gets you to focus on things you cannot control. Like people are just like, oh my God, and you know, we could end up in another world war. And I'm like, dude, it's already started. Like, just chill. God said it's going to happen. And they're like, but this way, you can't control that. Like, you're not going to get up on some platform and be like, hey, I declare peace in the Middle East. Like, who is you? You is no one. You sitting there and you just sound crazy because you're like, no. Everybody stop fighting. Everybody love everybody, and we wouldn't have this problem. You might be the Antichrist. That's what he says. But he'll get you to focus on things you cannot control. Oh, I have this illness. You can't control that. All you can do is give it to God and follow what your physician tells you to do. Oh, but I have this issue. You cannot control that. Like someone's like, oh, I'm about to get fired. I can't control that. You know, get to work on time. That's the problem. It's not that the enemy's coming against you. I literally had someone like, they're like, I'm in such a battle. I'm like, why? They're like, I'm having problems at work. Why are you having problems? See, asking questions, you like get to the root cause, right? So I'm like, why are you having problems at work? Because my boss just won't let off me. Why won't your boss let off you? Because I can't get to work on time. And you think, see, dad mode. And you think the enemy is causing that. What time did you go to bed? 2? In the evening? Morning. What time do you have to get up? 4. Okay, there's your problem right there. That ain't the enemy. Get off of TikTok. Someone messaged me. I'm not going to say your name. You know who you are. Is the earth round? I said, get off of TikTok. Number two, he's gonna get you to focus on your lack, on what you don't have. See, if you were to look and say, oh, well, I need to get to this point in my life, he's going to get you to focus on everything that you don't have to get to that point. So first, it's focus on things you can't control. Next is focus on your lack. Number three, it fixates your focus on your past or the future. He'll bring it up so it keeps your focus in that one specific area. Oh, okay, I did this in my past. I'm like, of course God's not going to do this. Or you're looking at some future event and you're worrying about that when God says, I already know about the event. I already know about what you have to do. Just focus on me. How do you get your focus back on God? You start thanking him for what he's already done because he's moving. He never stopped. Focus on him, and you'll see him moving. And, like, I was going through this, and I was already in the book of Exodus because I'm really kind of doing a deep dive into basically all the stuff that we see because they did talk about the glass, and I was on that. And I found this scripture, and it kind of bugged me a little bit, but then I understood exactly how God moves. We're going to be in Exodus 23. I'm going to read verses 27 and 30, or 27 through 30. And it says, this is God. So the people of Israel are at the mountain. God's given them the commandments. He's now kind of like listing out their laws. He's just given them the laws, and then he's getting to this point where he's going to begin directing them to the promised land. And it says this. It says, I will cause the people ahead of you to feel terror and will throw into confusion all the nations you come to. I will make all your enemies turn their backs to you in retreat. I will send hornets in front of you, which I thought was pretty interesting. I'm like, really? Hornets? Well, the thing about it is, like, these things don't give up. Y'all ever poke a hornet's nest? They're mean and angry because you poked a hornet's nest. They don't leave you alone. Sting is horrible, and, they have a hornet that literally, like, it will find tarantulas, lay their eggs inside the tarantula because they're that massive. And then when the babies hatch, they eat the spider from the inside out. I'm sorry, my daughter's on National Geographic right now, and, like, that messed up my land. I will send hornets in front of you, and they will drive the Hivites, Canaanites, and the Hethites away from you. Why that's important is because their promised land is the land of Canaan. But there are people that have alliances with Canaan that are around their borders. So if God were to just drive out Canaan, when the people of Israel moved in, so to speak, the enemies or the allies of the Canaanites would turn around and begin attacking Israel almost immediately. I will, and this is what got me. I will not drive them out ahead of you in a single year, otherwise the land would become desolate and wild animals would multiply against you. I will drive them out little by little. And that hit me. Because I was like, oh, my God. When I started looking back at things that have gone into my life, it happened little by little. Didn't happen immediately. It was small moves that added up to a point to where I'm here today. I will drive them out little by little ahead of you until you have become numerous and can take possession of the land. So God is preparing them for what he's going to lead them into, their promised land, and it's inhabited. So honestly, like, when I look at this, I'm like, okay, y'all deserved 40 years in the wilderness. Here's God that's like, look at all the prep work I'm doing for your house. Like, look at everything I'm doing for this. And then they walk up and go, nah, not right now. Like, I'm like, y'all deserve it now. Like, I used to have some kind of, like, sympathy and be like, but God, like, the Canaanites were big. Like, come on, have some compassion. I understand they didn't take what you wanted, but seriously. And then I look at this and I'm like, okay, no, y'all deserved it. Because that's a lot of prep work that God's doing. God took his time preparing Israel, but he was also preparing for the destruction of their enemies. So he wasn't just saying, like, okay, I want you guys to wait here while I go and I drive them out. He's saying, as you close in your distance, I will push them further away until they're driven out from the land. So he wasn't just preparing Israel, he was preparing the destruction of their enemies that were currently occupying their promise. And when you read through in Exodus, they say, no, these people were gigantic, these people were huge, and like, we're grasshoppers to them, we're nothing. And like, look, there's going to be some giants that are occupying your promise. Okay? There are going to be some things that God says, I'm going to give to you, but there's going to be some giants on it. And you're going to have to look at it and say, okay, God, I cannot overcome this. I cannot defeat it. But I know that if I keep moving in this direction, you will continue to drive them out. See, the giants are just there all for pomp and circumstance. They're there just to kind of like hype up the situation. That's why Goliath was who he was, because he didn't send out the entire army. He said, no. I got this. I'm going to run out there. I'm going to say, yo, send me out your best. And he's just standing out there. They didn't send the entire army. It was just Goliath. It's all pomp and circumstance. And God sends a child with a toy to defeat it. So there's going to be some giants that are occupying your promise. And I don't care how big they might seem. I don't care how tall it might feel. God says that the taller they are, the harder they fall. All you got to do is keep walking little by little. And it might not happen immediately, but it's eventually going to happen. See, it's knowing for me, like, if I can claim it and God has promised it to me, it will not pass me by. Little by little, I'm going to keep pushing forward. Little by little. See, there are times God asks you to just walk in your faith, and sometimes it feels like it's a big step, but sometimes you just got to do it little by little. I'm going to go, and I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. I'm going to make sure that I'm still moving in your direction. But God says that he has to build you up so you can manage the promise appropriately. And he does it little by little. And I always thought, like, I have a friend who, he's a bodybuilder. He spoke here before. And I'm just like, you know, how do you go from, because I kind of remember him when he was, like in his early 20s. And he wasn't, like, massive. And I'm like, bro, how did you go from that to, like, this beast? And he's like, oh, it just happens. I mean, I would say little by little now because it would make sense. I don't think he said that. But he's like, it's really just going in and, like, starting off slow, get your reps in. And then he's like, and at a certain point, like, you start really kind of, like, putting some weight behind it. He's like, but it doesn't happen, like, in a month. And he's like, and people always get discouraged because he used to be a trainer, and he'd have a bunch of people show up, and he'd put them through all these exercises, all these things, and then, like, half of them would be gone in, like, 2 weeks. And he's like, why? They're like, I don't see anything happening. And he's like, well, when you start going on the diet that I asked you to go on, you'll start seeing that under all of the adipose tissue, we were building under it. But it happens little by little. See, God can see the enemies that you can't see. He can see the beasts that you can't see that would devour anything that you build with what God promised you. There's this really horrible, it really is like, it's pertaining to Jesus, but just kind of like bear with me for a second. There's a shepherd. He goes out and he's keeping his sheep. And this one just likes to run out. And so he goes over and he goes and he grabs it, brings it back into the herd, just keeping him in the grazing area. Little sheep goes back out. He grabs it, brings it back in, does it like 4 or 5 times. Well, on the 6th time, he comes back and he's holding the sheep on his neck. And he broke the sheep's legs. Harsh, right? Like, bro, you're supposed to take care of him. But see, the thing is, he could see the wolves on the other side of the hill that the sheep couldn't. And it's just running out into danger. And he comes out and he says, no, because I can see the beasts that you can't. I can see the enemies that you can't. So it's going to happen slowly because I have to drive them out while I'm preparing you to take care of the promise. The promised land was massive, and it's not Israel what it is today on our maps. It encompasses parts of Egypt, like all of Syria, Iraq. Like, it's insane how massive the land was that God promised them. So it's massive. And he says, if I were to just wipe everything out, by the time you got there, it would be overrun with beasts. We're worried about God's timing, and God's like, no, like, it ain't about my timing. It's about what I'm doing on the outskirts of what I promised you. It's what I'm doing. I'm driving the beasts out. Don't think that God will prepare you in the promise. God prepares you for the promise. Oh, sorry. He prepares you for the promise. You're upset with where you are, but God brought you to that place to prepare you for where he's taking you. You may not be happy, but you've come a long way in this journey, and you still might have a ways to go, but you're growing gradually. You make progress little by little. You want the end result, God wants the journey. You want the promise, God wants the heart. And there are times like you'll start seeing things happening when it comes to like your growth. And I never did this with my daughter, and I don't think my parents ever did this, but there's a point like you put your kid up against a wall, right? And then you're like marking their height so they can see exactly how much they grow. A lot of times when people are like, God, why do I keep dealing with this one problem? Because God's like, look back at your growth. Like the last time you dealt with this, it took you months. You did it in days. And then the next time when you're facing it, it's not going to be days, it's going to be hours. Because he's building you up to manage where he's taking you. When God calls you to do something, though, he doesn't check your bank account first, which when God called me out to do something, I'm like, really? You see that, like, I'm almost in the negative here, right? He doesn't check the bank account first to make sure you can afford it. He doesn't make sure you have the talents or the skills or the abilities necessary to do what he's calling you to do. He calls us to do things that would be impossible for us to complete on our own. So that's causing us to walk by faith. And once we do that, only then does God show you how possible it actually is. So there's a point where someone was going to be doing something, and I'm at the movies with my mom, and she's just like, what are we going to do? And I was like, oh, I'll do it. And she's like, son, you don't do any of those things. And I said, yeah, I know, we'll do it. I had to teach myself how to play the guitar. YouTube is of no benefit when it comes to, like, beginners, because everybody just wants to show off, like, how good they are, right? So I'm like, okay, forget it. I'm just going to do it on my own. And, like, just those things that God begins to call you out into this, and he says, I'm not calling you out because I've prepared you. I am calling you out to step into it so that you can begin to prepare yourself for where I'm taking you. You still have some work to do. Like, I find that interesting. People always pray for things and just assume they don't have to do anything else. Like, I prayed, do it. And God's like, yeah, you prayed, I heard you, and it is completely under your control. You can stop it. See, God doesn't deal with the piddly little things that you deal with. You're like, God, just help me wake up earlier. You can control that. You can set an alarm a little bit earlier. You can get off the gram. You can get off the talk, like, a little bit earlier. You can do that. God's not going to be like, I'm going to send an angel down to wake you up at the appropriate time when you yourself spent all that time wasting. Like, no, there are things that are under your control that God says you can do. See, Israel, God didn't come down and say, I'm going to teach you how to fight to protect your promise. He's telling them, because he literally kind of goes through all the laws and he's talking about, like, people kind of like taking up arms and things. And he's like, you can do that. I'm going to go and drive them out as you guys draw near, but you still have a part to play in this, and that part is you still have to prepare yourself where you're at. You may not like it. God doesn't really care, because he says it's for his purpose, his will. And if his purpose and his will and he is good, then his purpose, his will, regardless of where we're at, is still good. God is doing something through it. So that's belief. Like that goes beyond faith. That goes into belief. And belief is far more important than knowledge. Knowledge says, as soon as I know how to do it, I'll do it. But belief says, if you've called me to do it, then in Jesus Christ's name, I will walk into it, and I'm going to prepare myself wherever I'm at if it's something that I got to pick up. Because I'm not much of a singer, and if you all remember the early days, because when I started preaching, like, getting hard into it, I was telling my wife, I was like, I can't sing anymore. Like, my voice is just gone. And she's like, oh, okay. But, like, I didn't really sing. I screamed. And God still used it. Someone once texted me, and they're just like, why do you sound like Dave Grohl? And I was like, oh, my God, thank you so much. And he's like, no, I meant that as a joke. I was like, Dave Grohl is my hero. And if you didn't know, that's a song by the Foo Fighters. And I was like, thank you so much. And he's like, you don't have to scream in church. I was like, I do. Because that's the only way I can get anything that kind of sounds harmony out there. Everything God has brought me to, I had to invest in it. Time, effort, money, and little by little, we ended up getting there. And ask my wife, I spent so much money on pedals, guitars. Because as I would advance, I'm like, I need more. And little by little, until you're prepared for what God wants you to do. And there's kind of an interesting way that Jesus even puts this out. When he's doing the parable, he's up on the mount, he's preaching his sermons, and we get to this one in Mark. And it's in chapter 4, it's in verse 26 and through 29. And he says, the kingdom of God is like this, he said. A man scatters seed on the ground, and he sleeps and rises night and day. The seed sprouts and grows, although he doesn't know how. The soil produces a crop by itself. First the blade, then the head, and then the full grain on the head. As soon as the crop is ready, he sends for the sickle because the harvest has come. And it's really interesting because, like, he just drops that on them and then, like, goes to another, like, another subject. I'd be like, I'm sorry, can I get some context here? Like, so the kingdom of God is a bunch of farmers? Like, I'm a fisherman. I don't know how to farm. I always think of myself because my ADHD acts up. Like, I'm always like, man, if I was there, like, did they have people as sarcastic as I am? Like, you know, he's like, hey, the kingdom of God is like plowing a field. I'm a physician. I can hire people to do that. Is that okay? But, like, just the thing that he tells them, he drops this on him and then just immediately switches to another sermon. And, like, doesn't even follow up with that. But what he's talking about is he's talking about the growth is gradual. It needs to be measured, otherwise you never realize that you have grown because it happens little by little. When you put seeds in the ground, if you put, like, I don't know, tomato seeds, I guess. If you put that in the ground and you water it, you're not going to see tomatoes tomorrow. Say that 30 times fast, tomato tomorrow. You're not going to see it. What are you going to see? Dirt. In a week, what are you going to see? Dirt. Why? Because everything that needs to happen happens underground. There's a specific time where the blade will pierce the dirt and you'll start seeing something grow. But it happens little by little, and most of the time you don't even see it happening. Unless, or I guess you can see bamboo growing. But you're going to sit there and you're going to say, I planted it, and eventually I'm going to see tomatoes. But eventually you're just going to end up seeing the blade of grass or the blade that pierces the soil. And then you're going to start seeing it branching out. But it's not going to happen immediately. It's going to happen little by little. And Jesus is kind of putting that to him this way. Sometimes God wants to show you through these seasons so you can measure your faith. God, I've been through this so many times. And like I said, yes, you have. But you've come so far. Because the last time you dealt with this, it almost took you out. Now it doesn't even disrupt your sleep. But why do I have to deal with it? Why do I have to keep dealing with it? Because it's growing you. It's growing your faith. It's growing everything about you. And eventually you'll be impervious to whatever the enemy is trying to bring against you. Your struggles, your addictions, and eventually you hit a point where, I mean, I wouldn't like advise you to do this, but you hit a point where someone told me, they're like, I've overcome this one thing, and every time I see it, I flip it off. I would not advise that. We as Christians should be loving. Can you just avoid it, maybe? But I get that sentiment to where you've come through so much and you've come so far that when the enemy tries to bring it up once again, it starts to anger you rather than cause you to be tempted. Because when he comes and he puts it up, you're like, okay, bro, keep trying. Keep trying to bring that up, because you know what's going to end up happening is I'm just going to sit here and I'm going to stand on the word of God and I'm going to tell you, you can't come against me with this anymore. I've overcome. I found my victory in Jesus Christ. What else can you bring? But Pastor, I'm going through it. I just feel like everything's working against me. Well, you know what? Hold to your faith and keep moving forward little by little. And there's something that we need to understand. Stop comparing your growth to other people. Some people look at it and they're like, wow, like someone had told me, apparently when you own a Jeep, the dirtier it is, the better. So I just stopped washing my Jeep because I'm like, I want to look cool to Jeeps or like Jeep people. But this kid, I was getting in, I was at a Save Mart, and this kid's like, oh, wow, like, I've always wanted a Jeep. I was like, same here, buddy, like, high five. And he's like, are you going to lift it, and are you going to put big tires on it? And I was like, I'm not that much of a Jeep, like, I'll drive it. And he's just like, man, how do I get one of those? And I was like, you go to school. What grade are you in? He's like, I'm in third grade. I said, okay, you got about 10 more years to go, so, or 14, sorry. And I'm like, yeah, you got to do this. And he's like, and then what do I do? I said, you get a really good paying job. And he's like, oh, I got to get a job to get that. And I was like, and I looked at the mom, and I was like, can you buy him a Jeep? And she's like, no. And I said, sorry, bro, you're going to have to get a job. But we can't measure what we have against others, because you don't know the soil that they've tilled. You don't know the seeds that they've planted, and you don't know the tears that they've cried over this, like watering the seeds that have been planted. You don't know what they've been through. And I love it when people come to me and they're like, well, I don't, they'll tell me like issues, and I'm like, all right, I've dealt with the same thing. And they're like, God, seriously? I thought I was the only one. I'm like, nope, same thing. And we go through and we talk about it. But people look at it and they say, well, why can't I get over it like he got over it? Because you didn't see the seeds that were planted. You don't know how long it was planted. And you don't know how long it took him to unroot those things that were surrounding his promise, choking it out. You don't know. So don't measure yourself against others, because you have no idea what they've been through. You don't know the storms they've been through. Slow and painful growth, and they didn't give up. You're not at the same place they are, but don't get discouraged and make you think, well, I'm just not growing. Little by little, you're growing. Look back at the progress. I love telling people when they complain to me, they tell me stuff, I bring up a positive about it. So someone might be like, oh, but I lost my job and I did this and I have all these medical conditions, and thank God for something like Medi-Cal that you could get on. Oh, but I have this issue, I have that, and thank God that insurance exists. Or they're like, oh, and my car keeps breaking down and it keeps doing this, and thank God every time you do something else, it changes and it gets better. Stop focusing on all the negative. Stop focusing on what you don't see growing, because the growth sometimes is happening more underground before you start seeing the blade of grass pierce. You're not at the same place you were before you hit this. The seed takes root before the blade pierces the soil. See, the seeds that you plant in your life are going to grow. You reap what you sow is completely biblical. Like, I was going through these things of like all the like horrible sayings that people use and say, oh no, that's biblical. Jesus said it. No, he didn't. This one's biblical, where he says you reap what you sow. So if you are sowing hatred and anger, you're going to reap hatred and anger. If you're sowing joy, you're going to reap joy. If you're sowing peace, you're going to reap peace. I do that all the time. I am sowing peace into people all the time, because I'm just like, when they start spiraling, getting out of control, I'm like, hey, everything's fine. Everything's good. We're going to get this taken care of. Don't worry about it. And I receive peace in return, because when I start spiraling out of control, they're like, oh my God, we're all going to die because Will's got this. And if he's going crazy, we got to calm this fool down. And they do. I get texts, hey, calm down. But you reap what you sow. And with these seasons, with all this going on, and little by little, Jesus puts us in a parable when he talks about the servants and the talents. He goes through, and it's a master comes up. He takes his servants out to this bazaar. He gives one five talents. He gives one two talents, and he gives one talent according to their abilities. See, I love when people say, like, why doesn't God give me the same thing that he gave you? Why doesn't God give me that? Because it says according to their abilities. So there are people that God will trust with certain blessings and not trust others, because he says, I know what it will do to you. So when it comes to the talents, they go and they start sowing. Two of them do. They go and they sow. The one that has five, he starts investing. I don't know if Bitcoin was around. I doubt it, but he would have probably been buying Bitcoin and saying, like, okay, I'm going to see my return. And he does. He gets a double return. The guy that has two, he's doing the same thing, just at a lower level, right? He's doing day trading. He's trying to find something here and there. He's just lending money out and putting a simple interest on it. He doubles his money. But the one that gets one, he buries it because he's like, oh, master's angry. And if I lose it, he's going to be angered. So the two that gave, they reaped. Because when they go to the master, they try to give it back to him. He says, oh, no, that's on you. That's on you. You guys are good. When it comes to the one that didn't, the one that buried it, he's like, what did you do? Like, I'm going to take everything from you. Because you didn't do what I told you to do, and that was to use the money. You're still going to have to put in the work with where you're at and what you've got prepared for yourself, where God is taking you, because he's going to bless the work that you put into it. And I have found that out to be truth more than anything. The amount of work that we put into the building starts to show. It starts to reap. I start looking at it, and just all the work that you do outside of the church, everything that you do that is moving you closer to your promise, God says, I'm still blessing that work. And you'll sow from it. And like, I like people that are like, oh, I just want a double portion. I want double portion. God's like, you ain't even dealing with the single portion. I gave you a single portion. You can't even manage that. So if I give you a double portion, you're just going to waste it. We aren't here praying like that. And I love that God says, I'll drive them out little by little. God isn't saying, stay here while I get rid of them. He says, as you approach your promise, I'm going to be driving them out. As you grow, as you develop, I drive the enemies further away. I drive the beasts of the field out. But you got to keep moving forward little by little. Because when you pray, God says, I'm already on the work. I'm already working for it. I already knew you needed it before you even prayed for it. So just let me work with it. And it is going to happen little by little. They're those big things that I wish I could just pray over someone and their afflictions just leave them immediately. And God does do that. He chooses to do that. But most of the time, it's going to be little move by little move. And it's for a purpose. I went and met with one of our parishioners, one of our members, going through chemo. And I can't tell you, like, I was walking, they're in Bays. If you've ever been to a Clovis Community Cancer Center, they're in Bays. And as I'm walking by each bay, like, all I can feel is just, like, sadness. There's people crying. There's people that are just sick, you know, and it just felt so sad. And I get to this bay, and, like, I didn't even have to, like, look and say, are you in there? Like, I could just feel it, and I'm like, something's different about this bay. Let's walk in here. And so I just step in, and she's sitting right there with her husband, and they're just, like, just so bright. She's going through the worst thing that you could go through, and yet she's just sitting there so bright. And the way you can tell that, like, a Christian has walked in and by faith they know that God is going to do something with this is when other people come in and are happy and are joyous. These nurses, they try to stay upbeat, but they're tired, right? They're downtrodden. They have to go through so much, like, bureaucracy just to get there. And the nurses are running in and they're laughing about, like, something that they did. And they're telling her. Like, they're telling, like, oh, my God, we had this thing where we had to go find the ducks, and we didn't know it was at a certain time, so we just came in and we were taking them. So we have, like, 40 ducks, and then we just found out that there's a certain time, so we basically have all the ducks. And she's like, what do I do? And we're like, keep them. Like, if they didn't explain the rules well enough, that's on them. But it's like people were coming in, and they're just joyous. And that's the kind of thing that I look at, and I'm like, something has been planted that has taken root in this heart and is already beginning to produce fruit. Because you can't tell me that someone who's facing the worst things you can face is just sitting there smiling and exuding joy and peace when all others look like they're just out. But if God slows you down, don't stop. Little by little, keep moving. If God takes a detour, follow him. Little by little, knowing that through faith, that through his timing, his purpose, his plan, and his will, you will get there. Stay focused on God. Keep moving. Take the next step. Even if it's a little step. Well, that's a little step. Celebrate the small victories. Stand your feet with me if you will. I don't like when people are like, oh, yeah, I did this and I did that. I'm like, well, how did you get there? I got there by doing this. That's a victory. Celebrate the small victories. Someone's like, oh, I got to go into a job interview. And they're like, oh, Pastor, like, I went into my interview, and, man, I just feel like I didn't do that great. Did you get a second interview? Yeah. Bro, that's amazing. How many applicants? 480. And you got a second interview? Yeah. But I'm up against, like, this other guy. No. That's a victory. Celebrate the small victories. Don't let those go by, because little by little, you'll start seeing just how much you've grown, just how far you've come, because each little step has got you to where God needs you to be. When Jesus was walking on water, and Peter calls out and is like, look, hey, if that's you, like, tell me to come out to you. Jesus is like, dude, get out of the boat. And he gets out. Now, imagine this. I wouldn't have been that worried after you get out of a boat and you already know, okay, my foot is supposed to sink, and it didn't. Like, right there, I'd already be excited. And he takes the first step, loses focus, and starts going down. Just remember, it's little by little. When you're praying, it's happening. The healing is happening, but it's happening little by little. God is still moving. God is still here. He is intertwined with you. And when you voice your prayers, God says, I've heard them. I hold no good thing away from you. And little by little, I will get you to where I need you to be. Let's bow our heads. Father, we come before you this morning, Lord God, so thankful, Lord, for your word, so thankful, Lord God, for your son that you've sent down, Lord God, as our Savior. Father, if there's anyone in this place that has not received Jesus Christ, the time is drawing near, the signs are getting heavier, we already know that we know God is coming back, and if you don't have him, you just raise your hand right now, we'll get you in there, we will pray the sinner's prayer, and it's an immediate salvation. And we are all saved. Father, I pray right now, Lord God, you begin to show us, Father, little by little, Lord God, that we are making our progress. That, Lord, even in the times where we're so fearful, Lord God, where we feel like everything is starting to fall apart, Lord, it is little by little that we're going to get there. Father, I pray for my sister, Lord God. Lord, that in these times, Lord God, that she's feeling, Lord, things are falling away. Lord, it is little by little that each small move will add up, that each thing that you have to face is little by little. He says it's gonna happen. He says it's gonna move, but you gotta have faith and just keep moving forward little by little. And sometimes you're gonna have to drag those babies out, and you're gonna have to say, no, you are coming to the house of God, because God is gonna keep moving, and little by little by little, you will get to where God needs him to be. You will get to where God needs you to be. But right now, Lord God, but you just begin to show us, Father, that our miracles, Lord, that you are still moving, you are intertwined with us, and when we lift our voices, that Father, you are there, you have heard, and Lord God, you are going to bring all your promises to fruition. Lord God, it may not happen immediately, but it's going to happen little by little. But Lord, if we were to look back at where you've brought us from, Lord, we would see how far we've come to where we are today. And Father, we thank you for each step, Lord God. We thank you for each move, Lord God. We thank you for all that you are. In your holy and most precious name we pray. Amen and amen. Can you put your hands together this morning? Little by little, it happens. Small moves took a step in the right direction. And God says, that's good. I'm going to bless it. Let's go for the next step. Don't stop here. Don't stop moving. Just keep going, little by little. We love you guys. We have a Bible study Friday night where people are bringing up questions. Doesn't matter what the question is. I can go biblical with anything. But we love you guys. We'll see you Wednesday night, 7 o'clock.